Και όλα τα τα.
I call Honey Harrera.
Mr. Speaker. Kia ora, Mr. Speaker. Tēnā tātou katoa e te whare. Mr. Speaker, in 2011, I made Feed the Kids Manus' first ever major campaign, but I found that whenever I raised it around the House, I noticed that while we all know that child poverty exists, politicians were retreating behind glib phrases or saying nasty things about bad parenting or blaming the global financial crisis or going quiet to fit with the party line and refusing to deal honestly and openly with what has become a major disgrace in 21st century Aotearoa. And unfortunately, whenever they're in government, both major parties struggle to admit that child poverty is a problem, but happily attack those in power about it as soon as they go into the opposition. So wouldn't it be nice, Mr. Speaker, if for once, just this once, both the Prime Minister and the Leader of the Opposition called a joint press conference, and yes, Russell Norman and Matidi Atude and Winston Peters and Tariana Turia and Peter Sharples and even Peter Dunn can be there too if they wish to say, on behalf of the Parliament of New Zealand and the people of New Zealand, we want to acknowledge a major problem in our society called child poverty. It's been something we've been shuffling to the sidelines for too long, but today we freely admit that child poverty exists here in Aotearoa. We're not proud of it. In fact, we're bloody ashamed to admit it, but we're going to do something about it. And as the leaders of the two major parties in Parliament, we want everyone to know that as we move to take up our place as a leading nation in the world, we begin that journey by recognising the reality of child poverty and taking steps to eliminate it as a bipartisan priority of the highest order. Now, wouldn't that be great, Mr. Speaker? Wouldn't that be something worth cheering for? Wouldn't that be something to be proud of? And just imagine what a difference that would make to those families living on the edge. I mean, what value the trade deal with the USA or the military parade in China if when we get home we've still got 270,000 kids living below the poverty line? I'd love it if we had a Feed the Kids program at every school in the country so no child missed out, with coordinators helping organise local businesses to work with their schools to help families come in to cook, to get people in to teach kids how to make a garden, grow kai, prepare kai, cook kai, and even how to clean up afterwards. And to those who say that feeding the kids is a parent's responsibility, I agree with you. But let's agree also that providing the environment where stable families can function well in our society is a government's responsibility. And the fact is that in 2013, we have whole communities locked into long-term, intergenerational unemployment, facing crippling welfare cuts, having to deal with rising electricity prices, medical charges, school fees, food bills, house rentals and fuel costs, and worrying themselves sick lest one of their kids gets ill, or the car breaks down, or there's a cold snap, or they miss the wind's appointment. And on top of that, we also have the Children's Commissioner's Expert Advisory Group on Solutions to Child Poverty, telling us that poverty is costing the country $6 to $8 billion a year, and that we have 270,000 children living in poverty and some 100,000 kids going to school hungry every day. Now, these are not problems caused by bad parenting, Mr. Speaker. These are problems caused by decades of bad economic choices and flawed decision-making at government level. Remember, it wasn't the poor who caused the global financial crisis or caused the banks to go belly up or bailed out the banks and failed finance companies with taxpayer money. No, those were all macro decisions, big picture choices made not by bad parents but by bad governments. And that's why governments must honour their responsibility to provide for our most vulnerable citizens, the kids, until families are able to once again take care of themselves and their children. I would have been happy to support any efforts to eliminate child poverty, however small, because feeding even one child is a good idea. And that's why, Mr. Speaker, given all the positive comments from the Prime Minister over the past few days and the Māori Party bragging about how hard they're fighting for the poor, I am bitterly disappointed to see that this budget has set aside not one cent to deal with child poverty. If I could, I'd organise Feed the Kids gigs like we had in Ōtara last month, right across the north, from Morewa to Mitimiti, Te Hapua to Te Atatū, and whangareitu, whangaparawa. And then I'd take it on the road right across the country just to see happy kids, because nothing beats seeing 2,000 kids happy just to get a feed, see some celebrities, jump around, sing and play, and go back to school with a full lunch. I'm glad we have more time to take the scope up on the road and to take another shot at convincing politicians that the Feed the Kids bill is worth supporting, even if it's just through Select Committee. Thank you, Mr. Dunn. And while I'm talking about kids at school, let me talk about what's happening in the field of education, and specifically Māori education, because yesterday I blasted the Māori Party for voting for Act's charter schools, when charter schools will have no accountability to whānau, to the reo, or to te aho matua, no obligation to put registered teachers in front of our kids, no transparency under the Official Information Act or the Ombudsman Act, and they're going to get heaps more money than Kura Kaupapa ever got. And yes, of course, I can hear Māori calling for different options to mainstream schools, but why do you suppose they're doing that? Because the racist education system we've got right now sucks, that's why. And because for the last 5 years, the Māori Party have done bugger all to change it. That's why. The Māori Party doesn't have any options. And because they don't have the power either to get money for Kura Kaupapa Māori, or to keep Kotahitanga going, or to get Manaaki Tauira reinstated, they're left pasting a Māori name on an Act policy and then trying to sell it to Māori. And I mean, really? No accountability to whānau? No commitment to the reo? No responsibility to te aho matua? Don't have to accept Māori kids? No appeal if they throw Māori kids out? And no obligation to put registered teachers in front of our kids after telling all of our nannies that they can't teach in Kura Kaupapa Māori until they get a degree? And the Māori Party calls that a good idea? And instead of attacking me, why doesn't the Māori Party, with their millions of dollars in departmental money and hundreds of staff, actually come up with some basic bottom lines like what Mana does? Mana wants a formal commitment from the government on a date to implement the tribunal's recommendations on kohanga reo, equal funding for Kura Kaupapa Māori, elimination of the racist rules applied only to Kura Kaupapa Māori, compulsory Māori language in schools, specific increases in the achievement for Māori students at school, specific reductions in suspension and expulsion of Māori students from school, reinstatement and expansion of the Kotahitanga program to help teachers understand how to get the best out of Māori students, and reinstatement of the Manaaki Tauira funding to help all Māori students get into university. Mana will work with anyone to help grow Māori medium education and develop viable policies for mainstream education. But know this, anyone wanting to call themselves a Māori party and talk so much about Kaupapa Māori should be ready to be congratulated on their ability and challenged on their inability to deliver on Kura Kaupapa Māori. The Māori Party got nothing in last year's budget for Kura Kaupapa, and to nobody's great surprise, they got nothing in this year's budget either. And in terms of housing, let's be clear. Aotearoa has a housing crisis, fuelled by property speculators and supported by this government's refusal to impose a meaningful capital gains tax, which would force the speculators to offload properties, put houses back on the market, lower house prices, enable first home buyers to buy in the affordable housing market that the government is talking about, and allow the government to build proper homes for those on low incomes, because that's where the real need is. As a commitment to ensuring that every family in Aotearoa has a warm and comfortable home to live in, and then developing a home purchase program based on the same universal family benefit that gave every Kiwi an opportunity to own their own homes and made Aotearoa such a great place to live, because the need exists at the bottom end, and that's where the change has to take place. What is required is a simpler, more committed strategy. Impose capital gains tax on those with two or more properties to bring more houses onto the market at a price which enables first home buyers to get in. Build 10,000 state houses a year for the next 10 years for families on low incomes, with a policy which encourages tenants to plan for home purchases, enables them to do so through a universal family benefit. And apart from a commitment for more money to fight rheumatic fever, this budget, Mr. Speaker, has nothing but crumbs to deal with the massive problems facing Māori, Pacifica and Pākehā people struggling to make ends meet, or to deal with the ever-growing plight of our hungry children. As far as this budget is concerned, Mr. Speaker, all we wanted was to feed the kids. We didn't even get crumbs for kids. Kia ora tātou.
I call the Honourable John Banks.
Mr. Speaker.